And for many of us, this conference is a homecoming, right? Now, for me as policy director, what that means is that this place is every 2 years where I take my marching orders from all of you. Doing policy work is kind of like being a leech and a parasite. I take all of your ideas, all of your innovation, all of your inspiration, and then I try to figure out how to translate it into ways to get support, leadership, resources, and really institutionalize the amazing work that's happening on the ground. So, and one of the ways that I've been doing that is by going to federal government, federal agencies, and saying, did you hear about this really cool stuff? Why aren't you all over this? So I want to start off by saying, don't ask what you can do for HRC's policy department. Ask what the policy department can do for you, and then tell me. Because that's gotten us so much traction, and I would say within the federal agencies, there's no place that we've had stronger relationships, stronger partnerships, stronger support than from the Office of National Drug Control Policy. And this is becoming, for many, many years, under previous administrations, it was their drug control policy. It's becoming our drug control policy.
That's right, that's right.
And first, under the previous director of ONDCP, Gil Kerlikowski, who came from Seattle, he was a law enforcement officer, and we thought, oh, not another law and order guy. And then suddenly he was talking about overdose prevention. He was talking about, we're no longer talking about the war on drugs, we're talking about a public health approach. And then he did something really smart. He brought on as his deputy director Michael Botticelli from Massachusetts, who at the time was running the Massachusetts Substance Abuse Services Agency. Now, I'm from Massachusetts, and I knew Michael back in the day, and I can say this. Massachusetts has been on the cutting edge of a lot of things that are really important to all of us. Some of them good, some of them unfortunately, Massachusetts was on the cutting edge of the rise in heroin use, right? However, Massachusetts had an opportunity to learn a whole lot about what to do with it, and those lessons are being shared across the country and across the world right now. So, some amazing things that Michael was a part of, there was an amazing group of advocates, harm reductionist parents, who said, we've got to do more about naloxone. Michael was the right person in the right place at the right time to listen, to take that, and to institutionalize that. We had huge problems with access to addiction treatment. I remember when I was working in the Cambridge Needle Exchange Program, the hardest things to help people with were trying to find them a slot. We started to see a lot of promise with buprenorphine, and Michael was the right person in the right place at the right time to say, let's get this throughout our community health centers. Let's make this more accessible. Let's make this more available. Michael was also talking with his other state colleagues from other states running the substance abuse agencies and took a really strong leadership role at the National Association of State Alcohol and Drug Abuse Directors and put out some amazing policies. One of the really things that I use all the time was Massachusetts passed its own version of healthcare reforms several years ago, and what did they learn from that? It helped so many people. The people that were still falling through the cracks were people with substance use issues when they were trying to get healthcare, when they were trying to get treatment. And that's a lesson for all of us, because what we're about is making sure that drug users don't fall through the cracks. So I want to offer that you're not just here to give me my marching orders, you're here to give Michael his marching orders, because he's open for business. We have a drug czar who's listening. And I also want to say, Michael's a person who has that right combination of compassion, conviction, and commitment. So often you see one of those things, but those people are ineffectual at getting things done. Now, if you're like looking, reading the newspapers, you're wondering, is the federal government getting anything done? Is Congress getting anything done? What we've seen from our work in federal policy is that it's like an iceberg, right? Only the tip of it is visible, but there's all kinds of things happening below the surface. And we're here to help stimulate and spark that and support that. Now, Michael made a choice when he accepted my invitation to speak at our opening session. right? Because we know that harm reduction is still political, and it still gets politicized. Michael is the acting director of ONDCP right now. The president has nominated him to become the permanent director, and the Senate has to have a hearing and confirm him. Now, people who might be more politically cautious would say, this is not the time for me to get in front of a room of drug users and harm reduction advocates and open my heart. Michael said, sign me up. When is it? Where is it? I can't wait to go. And his office has been really great about supporting that. So, when I started doing policy work at Harm Reduction Coalition, these are words that I never thought I would say. The Office of National Drug Control Policy has our back, and we have their back. I'm going to take this time to pass the mic and introduce my friend, Michael Botticelli. Please give him a warm welcome.
Good morning, Baltimore.
Good morning.
Can you hear me? Good morning, Harm Reduction Coalition. So, and I really want to thank Daniel for that really warm and kind introduction. And you know, I intend to use kind of his approach to policy here. And when I was in Massachusetts, I shamelessly stole everything that good that people did, and I continue to make sure that we have that response at the federal level. And I will also say, you know, it's really interesting, but I think it's also kind of no coincidence that during my entire time working for the HIV/AIDS Department in Massachusetts and then the Substance Abuse Bureau of Massachusetts, that I never came to a harm reduction coalition conference. And I sent staff and everyone came. So it's somewhat, quite honestly, I think fitting that my first appearance here is as the acting director of Office of National Drug Control Policy. I think, I know. You know, I think all of you know that nothing happens by accident. So it's, I think it really is no coincidence that I'm here, and I really want to thank you for all of the work that you're doing today. And I'm really pleased to be opening this meeting. This year's theme, Crossroads and Intersections, Doing Together What We Cannot Do Alone, could not be more timely or more urgent. I am really pleased by the relationship that our office has had with the Harm Reduction Coalition, and that will continue to grow. And today I have the privilege of being here to discuss areas of common concern and urgency for all of us. I hope that my presence here reflects the Obama administration's commitment for continuing drug policy reforms. I do again want to thank Daniel for that introduction, but I also really want to thank Daniel and Whitney Englander and Alan Clear for their continuous engagement and collaboration with our effort to make sure that our federal policy reflects the needs of people on the ground. Our partnership is formed around common goals, including saving lives. They are helping us find new ways to move the drug reform agenda together. I want to talk a little bit more about the Office of National Drug Control Policy, or ONDCP, and what we have done during the Obama administration regarding drug policy and identify opportunities for working together in the future. There are three issues that I want to discuss today: sentencing reform, prescription drug abuse prevention, including overdose prevention, and medication-assisted treatment. ONDCP is mandated by statute to publish the President's National Drug Control Strategy, which lays out the administration's approach to drug policy along action items worked out in coordination with our federal partners. In 2010, the inaugural strategy included a chapter devoted to breaking the cycle of drug use, crime, and incarceration. When I was in Massachusetts, I remember the words of former Director Kerlikowski, basically saying that we cannot and will not arrest and incarcerate our way out of this problem. The Department of Justice is responsible for one of our greatest achievements to date, a completed item to reduce sentencing disparities between crack and powder cocaine. Despite scientific evidence that crack and powder cocaine cause similar physical, psychological, and social effects The U.S. Sentencing Commission had a long-standing rule in place that provided much stiffer penalties for crack cocaine sales. I've seen this impact of the rule firsthand. A few weeks ago, in celebration of recovery, I invited several folks in recovery to come to the White House. One of those guests was a man named Michael Baynard. Michael was born into a rough neighborhood in Compton, California. He was a bright teenager, and his mom did her best, but the circumstances he was born into prevailed, and he got mixed up with a gang in high school. He dropped out, he developed a substance use disorder involving crack cocaine, and found himself homeless, alone, and in despair. In 1996, he was arrested and convicted for possession of less than a gram of crack. Under California's three strikes law, he was sentenced to 25 years in prison. In prison, he stopped using drugs and spent his time appealing his sentence. In 2002, 6 years after his conviction, his appeal went to a U.S. District Court where a judge named Spencer Letts, after carefully reviewing his case for 2.5 years, overturned the sentence and freed Michael. Since his release, Michael has spent his time mentoring others in recovery and working to prevent teens in Compton from joining gangs or using drugs. He earned his GED and is now enrolled in college and working full time. Michael's story proves that behind a rap sheet, there is a real person, often struggling with a substance use disorder, who needs treatment more than he needs a jail cell. As you know, the crack and powder cocaine sentencing disparity disproportionately affects people of color. Admittedly, these reforms have not completely eliminated these disparities, and there is more we can do in this area and more we must do. Over the next 2 years, this administration will continue to focus on reducing disproportionality in our criminal justice system, diverting people away from arrest and incarceration, and reducing the consequences of having a criminal record. After our inaugural strategy, it became apparent that abuse of prescription drugs, specifically opioid analgesics, was a serious issue that needed focused coordination and federal action. In 2010 alone, more than 38,000 Americans died from drug overdoses and drug-related deaths, and they outnumbered motor vehicle fatalities. Just over 22,000 of those overdose deaths involved prescription medications, and most of those deaths, almost 17,000, involve prescription opioids like OxyContin and hydrocodone. These are not illegal drugs. They are available by prescription through a regulated industry. New data from a study of insurance enrollees suggests that the rate of overdose deaths increases dramatically as the rate of opioid use increases. To address the problem of non-medical use and overdose, the administration in 2011 released its Prescription Drug Abuse Prevention Plan, which had the twin goals of reducing non-medical use and reducing negative medical consequences, including overdose, by 15% by 2015. The plan was meant to be an extension of our overall strategy, which calls for increased access to treatment, including medication-assisted treatment, and expanded availability of naloxone. The Prescription Drug Abuse Plan contains four pillars. Sorry, you know, I'm not good at working the slides and talking at the same time. So you'll have to read along. Given our former director's background in law enforcement, as Daniel talked about, we were also uniquely situated to work on access to naloxone for first responders. Law enforcement and first responder naloxone programs are particularly important because law enforcement agencies are in rural, suburban, and urban areas, and so is the overdose problem. So naloxone programs, combined with Good Samaritan laws, are making a difference. The Boston area has been hard hit by the opioid epidemic, as many parts of this country have, and police departments there have moved quickly to get naloxone into officers' hands. In February, ONDCP and Senator Ed Markey held a roundtable at a fire department in Taunton, Massachusetts. The room was packed with city council members, nearby mayors, and parents of children who had overdosed. In the middle of the discussion, a call rang out over the intercom. First responders were being dispatched to the scene of a possible overdose just a few streets away. The law enforcement community in that region has stepped up to meet the challenge, and it all started in Quincy, Massachusetts, where more than 300 lives have been saved by first responders with naloxone. You know, I know I represent the nation, but, you know, I see some of my friends here from Massachusetts who were really instrumental in getting that work done. So raise your hand and say thank you. Since that time, state and local law enforcement agencies across the country have begun to carry naloxone, and more states have enacted overdose prevention and Good Samaritan laws across this country. Our federal partners have also magnified our efforts. In June, the Veterans Health Administration recommended overdose education and naloxone distribution as part of medical care to at-risk veterans, and they have an interim policy for naloxone distribution. Their mail order pharmacies now carry naloxone, and this week the VA reported it already had 9 reported reversals. And it doesn't stop there. In July, Attorney General Holder and I convened a day-long conference on law enforcement and naloxone and issued an announcement urging federal law enforcement agencies to explore equipping staff with naloxone. In August, President Obama announced an executive action on military and veterans, which included Department of Defense law enforcement employees carrying naloxone. While opioid overdose is rare in active duty military, the DOD saw this as an opportunity for a federal agency to lead by doing the right thing and publicizing this life-saving tool. We have also been working to promote co-prescription of naloxone. SAMHSA and colleagues at the Boston Medical Center have partnered with us on webinars on overdose prevention for physicians with the American Psychiatric Association and the American College of Emergency Physicians. We have evidence to suggest that our activities are beginning to make a difference. In 2012, for the first time in over a decade, overdoses involving prescription opioids decreased from the previous year. At the same time, unfortunately, and as all of you know, heroin overdoses are clearly on the rise. While data suggests that only a small percentage of those who misuse prescription drugs transition to heroin, we know that 4/5 of newer heroin users began by misusing prescription pain medication. This tells us that we need to continue our efforts on focusing preventing the non-medical use of prescription pain medication, enhance our intervention efforts, and enhance better access and more timely access to treatment. Chronic prescription drug abuse and heroin use we know are intertwined, but it demonstrates that we must ensure that treatment is available, and particularly medication-assisted treatment is recognized as the standard of care for opioid addiction. Individuals in need of this medication for their substance use disorder should not be denied such treatment. According to the National Survey on Drug Use and Health, according to the National Survey on Drug Use and Health, we have a major treatment gap in this country. It is important that we work to make evidence-based treatment available with the same sense of urgency that we feel for increasing access to naloxone. We are committed to improving treatment access because we know that for many people with serious substance use disorders, medication-assisted treatment is crucial. It can mean the difference between homelessness and a substance use disorder, or full-time employment and recovery. It can mean the difference between hope or despair, between life or death. I had a truly serendipitous moment one morning this summer. This is a true story. I was running early for a round table with some of the leaders in the substance use disorder field. And we were meeting to strategize and to hear ideas about what more the federal government can do to reduce the magnitude of the opioid problem. Had a few minutes to kill, so as usual, I ducked into a nearby Starbucks to grab coffee. As I walked in, a woman introduced herself to me. It was her first week on the job, her first job since entering recovery. Her story started like so many. She was prescribed powerful opioid painkillers after surgery, grew dependent, and could not afford the price of prescription medications on the street, and began by injecting heroin. Her daughter was in college at the University of Maryland, but she found herself living on the streets. When she was committed to getting better, two things made recovery possible: supportive housing and access to buprenorphine treatment. We also know that naloxone won't save everyone. Some people will use alone, some people will be found too late. We cannot assume that naloxone is enough when many people who might have benefited from treatment fail to get it, perhaps because of a wait list, lack of insurance, or fear and shame. We are pleased that Dr. Joshua Sharfstein will be here at this meeting. A paper he recently published showed that expanding access to methadone and buprenorphine saves lives. Simply put, people maintained on medication-assisted treatment don't die. This tells us if we identify and treat folks before they transition to heroin, that we will reach our harm reduction goals. But we cannot expect people to treat themselves or diagnose themselves, and we must make treatment available. We are currently reviewing opportunities to leverage federal grant and contracting dollars to ensure government-funded medication-assisted treatment is provided to those who need it. Finally, I want to just mention that since the beginning of this administration, our office has been involved in ensuring access to other means to improve the health of people involved with opioids who began injecting. Despite the congressional ban on federal funds for needle exchange, we recognize that syringe services programs as part of a comprehensive public health effort to reduce infectious diseases from injection drug use and to help get injection drug users into treatment and eventual recovery. 36 states plus the District of Columbia currently have syringe exchange programs. We are working with our federal partners to implement the Viral Hepatitis Action Plan. It is particularly important to ensure that drug users in treatment are not categorically denied access to new cures for hepatitis C. We are also working with the Office of National AIDS Policy to reduce new infections among people who are injecting drugs, increasing the number of people who know their status and ensure those who have HIV are referred, engaged, and retained in care. Finally, I want to share a quote with you from President Obama. A few weeks ago, he said, "We live in cynical times, and Washington feeds that cynicism. But I always tell people cynicism never cured a disease. Cynicism never built a business. Cynicism is a choice, but hope is a better choice." As a person in recovery, I have learned that patience is essential. We must meet people with where they are and help more people on the path to better health. We have a lot to do, and we can and must and will do better. But we should all have faith. We have tools, we have naloxone, we have treatment, we know what works. But most of all, I think I know what's coming next. We have each other. Together, we can work toward the same mutual goals, to reduce the consequences of drug use, to prevent overdose deaths, to help people live safer and healthier lives. Thank you, everybody, for the work that you do, and let's get to work.